Okay, how's everybody feeling? You want to set this mic for us, please? So, you heard Maggie, right? Very inspirational, would you not agree?
Yeah.
Right? Maggie was beautiful, right? I was inspired, right? I think I got the chicken pox up here. I got goosebumps a bit, right? And then Eugene came up and shared with you the GPS that New York Life has established to help close the racial wealth gap, right? Some of what he shared, you should have been disturbed by. Would you agree?
Yes.
So we know what New York Life is attempting to do in the 1,100 agents in this agent-driven mission to change the financial future of Black America, but we don't have all the answers. We started an external campaign last year in August on a day that we proclaimed Cirilla McSween Billion Dollar Day. That was August 28th, where we asked all the agents across the country to join together and create $1 billion of tax-free transferable wealth into the African-American community. And these agents rose to the challenge. So we're going to do that every year from now on, right? If New York Life shuts it down tomorrow, we're going to do it anyway, right? That's a bold statement, right? Because I do have a mortgage and bills to pay. But that's how committed the folks in this room are to this movement. So this town hall conversation that we're going to engage in now is, what should we be doing, right? Because those of you who are here who've never heard about this, that's the issue, that's the problem, right? Because folks need to know what they don't know. So we're going to talk about what you're thinking, right? How are you feeling? Who do we need to go see in your community? Who do we need to talk to, right? What congressional leaders need to get involved? So I'm going to open it up now for a dialogue, and I'm going to ask us to just talk like folks. Let's pretend we're in Eugene's living room. You know, his house is big enough to fit us all in there, right? but that's what we're going to do next, right? So I'm going to ask you to just get real comfortable, just act like we're sitting around in the living room, got shoes kicked off. Right? You're feeling good? And then we're just kind of talking about what we need to do to make a difference in our market, in our community. So who wants to open up the discussion and tell me what you're thinking? I know you're feeling something, right? Because if I'm feeling it, you got to be feeling it, because I've heard it about 500 times. I get goosebumps every time, right? So someone start us off. Come to the mic, if you would, please. And if you want to make a comment or commentary, I ask you to be prepared to just come straight to the mic so we can keep the flow going. Tell us your name and share with us what you think.
Good evening. My name is Donna Rowland. I'm an agent in Houston, Texas, and I have worked in the community around the United States in the different cities where I've lived. One of the things that goes on in Houston every year is Money Week, and this is where we pull children in and teach them how to manage money. This is something that has been financed by banks and the organizations who help people clear up their credit. So as we educate the parents, and our parents are in different capacities throughout our communities, they're in the links, they're in the sororities, they're in the fraternities, they're working as volunteers in the schools and the hospitals, we will have to reach deep into our communities to educate. As we educate the parents, we have to educate the children in order to help the children to understand what their role is in the legacy of receiving this money. So I hope as we go back into our communities, wherever we are from, not only do we make an effort to support Black business and the businesses within our communities, but we give back through our children, through our churches, through our organizations. A number of us are involved in boards. We are involved in organizations from college, we are parents, we have Girl Scouts, we have Boy Scouts. We have many ways to meet the parents, educate the parents, help them understand what their role is as we reinvest in our communities. Thank you.
All right, thank you. So if I heard her right, she said educate the children, right? Did we all hear that, right? Okay, that's a good thing, right? We need to start them young, how to raise financially responsible children. That's what we all need to be about. But she also said these groups and organizations, okay? So as we pursue this, as we've plotted our GPS, we need ambassadors on the ground who can do what? Put these 1,100 agents who have this mission in front of these groups and organizations, right? I thought you mentioned sororities. Did you say sororities?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, any red and white in the room? How about a little pink and green? Any blue and white around? So I hear all that, but I need you to take me to your sorority session, your sorority gatherings, so we can have this conversation. Y'all get it?
Mm-hmm.
So that would make you a lead ambassador for the Deltas, a lead ambassador for the AKAs, a lead ambassador for the Zetas. This is how we're going to have to get the message out. So we know what we're doing. The question is, what are you going to do if you believe in this movement? Right? Make sense? So let's go a little deeper. Y'all feeling that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. My sister.
Oh, no, he was...
He was next?
Yes.
Yes, my name is Warren Green, and I work at the great institution, Morehouse College. I saw the piece about, you know, the 200,000 times the 250.
Yes.
I think one of the things that I deal with a lot of different people in a lot of different strata, I was blessed, my parents, you know, were educated, middle class, but mm-hmm. they always taught us to live. I live in the West End, in the community. And when people see those type of numbers, you know, it kind of sometimes we, you know, a lot of us here are very middle class and suited and booted and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
We have to kind of maybe tone down some of those numbers because they are frightening. Our people, like the brother said, are not educated to understand the power of money. And when they see those type big numbers, they just totally turn off. If we can have, you know, $100,000 policy, a $50,000 policy, because the premiums are real small and people can actually see from their day-to-day monies that they can, you know, build to go from 50 to 100 to the 250. Mm-hmm. And as we educate and expand this concept, because a lot of the information we don't know about how to use the policy to parlay to start a small business or to generate up the economic ladder using insurance. And that part, I think, if we can kind of, tailor the presentation to the different economic demographics of our people, mm-hmm. you know, and what they are motivated by, that would just be a suggestion that I have.
Okay. Thank you very much. Duly noted. Thank you.
My name is Kimberly Byer Clark, and I am an event planner here in Atlanta, but I'm also a very active member of the National Black MBA Atlanta chapter. Our conference will be here in 5 weeks. But I don't know if many of you are aware that Steve Harvey just had the Neighborhood Awards, or AKA the Hoodie Awards, where he highlights the black businesses, some of them not healthy, you know, fried chicken, soul food, but at least he's highlighting the businesses that we may not know about. Like, there was a soul food restaurant in LA I've never heard of that won. So next time I go to LA, I'll make sure to patronize that business, or Best Hair Salon, or Best Nail, piggybacking off of what Maggie's done with the empowerment experiment, where he's highlighting these amazing businesses, teachers, high schools, coaches, etc. He had about 150,000 people here this past weekend in Atlanta for his 3-day event. So I think he's done a lot in that regard for the last 12 years, highlighting those businesses. But there's also, to piggyback off the sister earlier about young children, there's a sister in New York by the name of Sabrina Lamb, who runs worldofmoney.org. And I hear somebody clapping. And she's a very good friend of mine and a mentor as well. And she does a 4-week camp in July in New York with kids from 5 up to 17. She has about 31 instructors, all people of color from Wall Street, teaching these kids about commodities, stocks, bonds, all the things that we did not learn coming up, how to go to the bank, etc. And she has a 4-week camp. She also takes them to China, and they learn Mandarin during the camp as well. So we need to support nonprofit organizations like this that are around, that are teaching our children. The kids are coming home and teaching the parents how to bank. So the roles are kind of reversed. So I think programs like that, we need to really, really support, because they're doing amazing things, and the kids are getting money during the 4 weeks to actually play in the stock market. And these kids get very excited about it. So I just wanted to highlight those two programs.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. So that sounds like to me, this is a young lady who has some folks already involved, who's very well connected. So I would challenge you to help connect us with that group that you're familiar with and you have a relationship with so we can get the word out. So I'm going to put you on the spot. Okay. Right? Are you willing to be an ambassador for this movement? Uh-huh. You will. Give this lady a hand. Right? Yeah. So we're going to pin you right now if you allow us. Right? So there's your first ambassador of the night. Give her another hand. Right? So that's how it starts. You guys getting it? Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Mimi Mickle from Cincinnati. And I just had a comment as I was listening to the brother from Morehouse speaking. I will tell you one thing. Sometimes I have been tempted, and this conference has been very good for me for that too, tempted sometimes to buy into that thinking that we have about life insurance. People will look at you and tell you, I can't do it. I can't afford it. I had a young woman tell me, because I talked to her, $450,000 of insurance, worth of insurance, based on what she said she wanted to provide for her children in the case that she was gone. That policy, 20-year term life policy, now it's not going to last her until she's 80 years old. Explain to you, you're going to have to do something different if you want to make this lasting. But you're trying to prevent your mother from struggling if she has to raise your two babies. That policy would cost her $39 a month. She had on a pair of shoes worth more than $39. She was going to a birthday party where she was going to spend more than that for a gift. She's taking the kids somewhere. She's going to spend more than that for pizza and the movies. We have to get our people to understand that they're worth more than the shoes on their feet, the pack of cigarettes they buy every day, and other things. And to let them know your worth is a whole lot more than you want to give yourself credit for. So I understand what you're saying. And different things, you know, costly and all that. But we have to help them to understand their worth and what they really can do with the dollars that they spend for things that aren't going to last them.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
A little taller. First, I want to thank you folks. This, for me, is extremely moving because you got 150 people here who are committed to creating black wealth, and that's special to me to see all of y'all here. So you should give yourself a hand of applause. And for your company to have one-third of all the various companies who are here at this conference is excessively impressive, and you should be proud of the people who are the leaders of your company for having that foresight. And I'm a little biased because my brother, Eugene, is a good friend for far more years than either one of us. I'm getting there. Would like to remember. And I appreciate the words that the sister shared about Sister Sabrina Lamb. What she's doing is incredible. But what I also want to let you know is the people who are teaching those classes are senior management at Wall Street firms. So senior VPs are coming. She's convinced them. And they're doing that because they understand how important this market will be 50 years from now. So if we ignore it today, we got a problem. White folks don't invest that far forward if there ain't no return on it, okay? And the second remark that the sister made, while I have an appreciation for what Brother Steve Harvey is doing, Brother Steve Harvey is making money. And if black people continue the idea of making the same 100 black people in this country wealthier, we are doomed. Sister Maggie is talking about collective community wealth. If you thought that video was hot, when you get done, buy that book and read them stories in that book. Okay? That's what we need to do. Because I saw them supporting Steve Harvey, but that was 75% concerts. Maggie's dropping jewels, and they in that book if you didn't hear it. I am an entrepreneur. As she said, I have restaurants. I also own, as part of a group of brothers who owns a hotel here in downtown Atlanta. And I was looking at the challenge there as to what can you do. And what I'm going to suggest to you as insurance people is I'm committed to seeing black people get into franchising, which is a $2 trillion industry, makes up 50% of retail sales. Think about where you get your coffee every day, where you get your donuts, where you get your gas, where you brought your whip. All of those places are franchises that we can own. and we're 1.5% of the game, okay? What you can do is, what most of you don't know is, franchises require key man insurance, require, as a condition of approval. That is a niche market that you can break easily. Simply call up the franchise and ask them for the phone number of their Hispanic Owners Coalition, of their Black Owners Coalition. If they don't have one, ask them for a list of Black owners, because he's required with his partners to have key man insurance. Further, before I sold them, I had 16 Church's Chicken restaurants in South Florida. We had 320 employees. In addition to us all being required to have key man insurance, our management people were required by my company to do so. My managers made 40, my district managers made 90, and my COO made $175,000. And we had 48 people in management who are also potential customers simply because you called me as a franchise owner and asked what my insurance policy is. They don't require that you use anybody, but what we have to start doing is getting on supplier lists, because what the franchise does is it recommends their friends. And they don't tell you, as a first-time entrepreneur, you're going to go with what them people suggest to you because you don't know. Get on those lists. Let them know you want to be an option. Make sure you, with pride, let them know that you're Black agents. So that's an opportunity for you to grow your business, because you're not just in the wealth transference business, you're in the wealth preservation business. So again, thank you, Eugene. Thank you, Maggie. Thank you, New York Life. Buy that book.
Yes, sir.
Good evening. My name is Wakesa Matsumoyo. I'm the co-director of AYA Educational Institute, and it's been wonderful being here this evening. Always inspired with my friend Maggie, and I'm really inspired to learn of this mission. And part of what I'm, when you ask what I'm thinking, this is so important that you are not just insurance agents who are making another sale. It's important right now because I see many of our children, their response to the Trayvon Martin killing and their response to the Sean Bell and Oscar Grant is to move away from Black. I want y'all to hear me now, okay? Our young people are sometimes in their awareness and sometimes out of their awareness, are moving away from what I like from Black. What I like is what you are saying, this combination with Maggie says we're not just insurance agents who happen to be Black. And we're not just going to make money that trickles down. That we have a mission to render distinguished service to our people. Now, I want you to understand that this is critical. And this modeling is really, really critical because it's a shift. You know, not too long ago, it was like, no, forget Black. All we got to do is make the green, right? Y'all remember that? My money is green. It's just about the green. What you're saying is, no, it is not just about the green. It is about the green. What did Maggie say? The blackest you can be? Is your money Black? This is important because as an educator, it's really key that we understand the mission is for us to render distinguished service to our people. I met with, talking about HBCU, I met with the president of Bennett College. My daughter went to Bennett College and graduated, after graduating from our school, went there. And she went there with the mindset of making it better. That is, wherever she would go, she was going to make it better. And so she chose Bennett. But after graduating, I sat with her president and I said, when she came back here, we had a community celebration and she had to stand before and answer these questions. And that is, while there at Bennett, did she learn skills that would allow her to render more distinguished service to our community? That's what I see you're talking about. That is, you're not just an insurance agent. Are you learning skills and a mindset, okay, that would allow you to render more distinguished service to our community? She had to answer another question. While there at Bennett College, did she make it a safer and a better place to be a proud Black person? Okay? So while at New York Life, while being professional, what you're saying, if you're carrying on this mission, is are you making it a safer and a better place to be proudly black, not a human being who just happens to be black? And she could say yes to that question. And then there was one more question that she had to be able to answer in front of 200 people in order for us to genuinely celebrate the degree she got there. And that is, did she stay clothed in her right mind? Okay? As my grandma would say, in this case, in her mind, as in terms of an identity of who she was to serve. And what I'm inspired by tonight is that you, as you, this partnership, you are modeling that. You become an educational force to model that at a time when it's critically needed. Keep on keeping on.
So I'd be remiss if I didn't suggest that we have some of our folks come and share this financial wisdom with your group and organization. So do you mind if I put you on the spot? Are you willing to are you willing to invite us to come and share financial literacy with your group and your organization? My man. Give me my hand. So there's another ambassador. Somebody please get this gentleman a pen. Eugene's got one over there. There it is. Give him another hand, will you please?
All right.
All right. Yes, sir.
Good evening, everybody. Lou Medina from Long Island, New York. And I'm an educator, so I educate my clients and prospects. I'm pretty passionate when I hear certain things because when I first came to this company, I really wasn't educated. I didn't know how much insurance cost. But then when I finally started looking at how much it really cost, $1.50 a day for a 40-year-old man is $1.5 million of coverage. Who comes to me to buy that? It was an Asian gentleman because he has properties and families and he cares about his family. I'm not going to get into all kinds of training and stuff, but the numbers aren't as bad as we think they are, especially if we're healthy. I have a 61-year-old aunt, can't get insurance. I have a 13-year-old nephew, they can't get insurance. So how bad is that? So we need to do this young, when it's really inexpensive. We need to get educated and get the facts because our perceptions really aren't in line with the numbers. $1.50 a day, it's not even a cup of coffee. And it could buy you a million, it could buy you 250, who knows what it is. We don't know what it is until we do the underwriting. But that's all I wanted to say is that we really have to get educated on really what it is, what it does, and it does a whole lot of things. When I sit in front of a CPA and I showed him a VUL product and I'd use low assumptions, he was like, my God, I want to be in your alliance. Now he's throwing me customers. It's all an education process. That's all I want to say. So thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Isaiah Thompson. I just live here in Lawrenceville. I'm not a New York Life agent. I just heard there's going to be some great speakers here tonight, so I figured I had to be a part. The question of what we can do as individuals here in this room is provide incentive to shop black. So many times as a young person I hear, oh, it's not convenient. Oh, it's out of the way. What can we, you know, why would I want to do that? I can get it from Walmart for cheaper. But no one understands that no one can see the benefits of shopping black. So by providing an incentive, a kickback, a coupon, you know, I'm 26, I have a family, I'm starting a family. Saving money is huge to me right now. Me and my wife had a hallelujah session about saving $10 at the grocery store. That was great. These small things, these pennies add up. So to provide an incentive, we're here, look, you can save $5 by shopping at X, or you can say, look, it's a black-owned McDonald's, here's a coupon, save this. I'm actually working on developing a project to do that for black-owned businesses starting here in Atlanta, and I don't own a New York Life policy, and it's a lot of money about to come my way, so if anybody wants to, you know, throw me a policy, I'd be more than interested in listening. But among us today, how do we provide incentive for more people to shop black? How do we make it cool or a cultural thing to want to do this? You know, we, as black people, they say we follow a lot of trends, but that's not the case. We start them. 60% of any trend is started by black people. We're the most emulated people on the planet. So we need to use that power, those strength in the numbers, like Mr. Eugene said earlier, to push a cultural shift to make it cool to want to save and to shop black. So how do we do that?
Thank you. Yeah, interesting commentary, right? So how do we do it, right? We do it person by person, house by house, street by street, organization by organization. And everybody's not going to want to get on the bus when the bus first shows up. So we have to roll with who? The believers first. Because what do we know? Followers follow the followers, right? And who do the followers follow? They follow the leaders. So when you pose that question to me, my first thought is, here's a young man that's starting a family, right? And so when you explain to all of your friends, right, that you've positioned your assets in a way that you have an income replacement strategy in place so that no matter what happens, your wife and your children are going to be okay, guess what you've become? A leader. And trust me, you will set your trend and they will follow you, right? So where did you go? I lost sight of you.
He's talking about insurance.
Okay, you're back there talking about insurance. Phyllis already got you, right? Okay, I appreciate that. That's what this is about. So here's how you make the difference, right? When you tell all your friends that you met this powerful lady who helped you position your assets so for generations your family's going to be okay, they'll do the same thing you do. And that's how the movement starts. So give this young man a hand, right? So he got it. He got the vision, and he says, I need to get some of that. Why? Because he was inspired, right? He was disturbed, and now he has the solution. And that's how it works in our community, right? Mr. Burrell says, black folks aren't just dark-skinned white people, right? Black folks have to be communicated to differently. And so that's what ambassadors do. So will somebody please pin this young man, right? Because he gets it, right? Yes, ma'am.
I was invited by Maggie, who sent me a text. Mm-hmm. My name is Allison. I own a small grocery store here with my brother. It's called The Boxcar Grocer. And it's interesting. I didn't know what I was walking into. Maggie just said, be there. And I got here late because we were working, but I got here. To hear everything that you've been talking about is very much stuff that our father talked to us about from a very, very young age. Mm-hmm. I was 25 when he passed away. He had a life insurance policy. That life insurance policy enabled us to pay off. I think he had a $250,000 life insurance policy. So my Columbia University education completely paid for. My brother's University of Denver education completely paid for. Any other debts that we may have had related to his funeral, related to anything, completely paid for. He had a number of real estate options. And I'm not telling you this stuff to brag about it, but there is a purpose to this because this is exactly what gave us the freedom to come back and say, now that we have freedom, we're not beholden to anyone's debts. We're not beholden to worrying about having to pay off house payments. We're not worried about having to pay college tuition. And my father very much wanted me to go to an Ivy League school, but his sister was actually vice president at Spelman. I did my time at Spelman, came down to Spelman for a semester, spent time down here, saw how it was done, went back to New York, graduated, came out of school. Amazing life experiences. And when my brother and I sat down to try to understand what it was about our community that we could really make a difference in, the two things that came to mind were obviously, the wealth gap is something that is very real and that very, very much exists. But we came back to land, and we came back to the lack of value that we have around land ownership. Mm. And what my father's land ownership allowed us to turn into our own personal assets and the freedom that gave us. And then from there, our health. And so how do we marry these two things along with all the things that our dad, both of our parents have talked about for years and years, which was the grocery store. So the grocery store wasn't just a grocery store. It was how do we really start to heal our community around health? How do we start to talk to people and communicate how important land ownership is? Because for how many of us, when our parents pass away, the first thing they want to do is sell the house, sell the farm. There was a disconnect that we were seeing between land ownership and farming and lack of stores in our communities where we actually had healthy food. And so how do we repair that? We're working with an organization called Saffron. A woman named Cynthia Hayes, amazing woman out of Savannah, is building her network of Black-owned farms to be able to grow a distribution network that can be used by stores like us. I'm working one-on-one with her. A group of us are working. So there's a whole movement. Maggie is an inspiration. We discovered her book when we opened our store. We happened to have opened our store during one of the worst recessions where nobody was lending. Mm-hmm. But because of the assets that we had built up, we didn't even have full-time jobs. We got a loan to open up a business in the middle of one of the biggest recessions that my generation had ever seen. So, and all of this was possible because my dad had insurance. Yeah, my dad, when I first came out of college, he made both of us sit down and sign an insurance policy. We're not even thinking that far. We're just trying to think what graduate school we're going to apply to. And he did that for us. So at this point, that insurance policy is something on my balance sheet that I'm able to loan against. So I just want to thank you guys for the work that you do. If anyone you want to use us for a story or a model around how all of that comes full circle and allows us to now give back to the community without having to go outside of our own family. And it's not something that we talk about a lot. People don't really understand where we got the money to do our store. Mm-hmm. But we self-financed our entire store. We didn't go to investors. We had a friend who put in some cash because he believed in what we were doing. But aside from some personal bank loans, like we don't have any state money. We don't have any outside money. It's all privately held by me and my brother. So.
Thank you. So for those of us who are here in Atlanta, right, here is a wealth is opportunity story that you're showing has volunteered to tell others. That makes her a what for you?
An
ambassador. An ambassador and a resource. So give her another hand. Yeah. Right? Yes, sir.
So I'm a talker, so I keep this brief. So today I would like to talk about one, solutions, and two, suggestions. And my solution for what has been proposed in regards to these questions, for one is Maggie's List, but also understanding how marketing works. People sometimes don't buy what you do, they buy why you do it. And you have to market why you do what you do. So as you begin to market what you're doing with the $50 billion and what we're doing with Maggie's List, keep pushing the story that Maggie has been promoting. Keep pushing the reason behind why Eugene got into the movement. Keep pushing that because they will buy into why you're doing what you're doing. The other thing is that people respond to quick access, and that's the key with marketing. If they have quick access to it, or they can see it, or they can touch it, they can feel it, or they can engage with it, or you can send them responses and they can be moved by it, they will keep marketing and they will keep moving with it. So you have to make sure that whatever you're marketing, whether it's Maggie's List or it's the $50 billion, that people have access to it quickly. And in today's time, between Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and social media and mobile applications and all these innovative tools out there, we have to have an action plan. Because people don't plan to fail, they fail to plan. So my suggestion for everyone is to put together a strategic action plan. Don't just talk about what you want to do, but plan it out. And figure out who you're gonna have to talk to make it happen and what tools and resources and steps you're gonna use to make it happen. Because if you start to promote what we're doing with Maggie's List, if you start to promote what Eugene is doing on your Facebook, on your Twitter, on your Instagram and you give them quick access by the touch of a button, they can see an article and know what to do. They have an action plan, they're gonna move on. The key to Maggie's List as a developer is not only to create a list of businesses and entrepreneurs that are black owned, but to also show their reputation, show you the reviews and the comments of these businesses. We're actually putting in a reputation model inside the app that will show you your own reputation as a business owner, but also show you what people are saying about you, and then offer you service, equip you and empower you to grow your business and change your reputation. Also, we're adding in a feature that will actually allow you to share that business, share Eugene and the 50 billion, the agents, to your social media. If you like that agent, share him through an email to 5,000 email friends by the click of a button. Share him to your Facebook, to all 2,000 of your Facebook members. Send his message or send his business card out to your friends via Twitter or Instagram. So by allowing access to businesses and allowing you the platform to share those businesses with others, you will also generate more business and generate a movement. So I just wanted to give that to you.
All right.
Hello, my name is Kim Coleman, and I'm with the Atlanta office. I'm going to read from the bottom to the top of the things that you asked. One of the things you asked was, what are the next steps as you see them? I am a Hebrew Israelite. A lot of you probably don't know what that is. I'm a black Jew. We talk about this constantly in our culture, in our synagogue. We talk about how are we going to do this for our community. We talk about it, but we don't do nothing about it. It's just talk. So my step is to go back to those individuals and tell them the action plan that the brother just mentioned about. Put it on social media, share that information. The black businesses that I do know that actually are working now, I am going to tell them about Maggie's List. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna go back to the university where my son was enrolled at, talk to the dean, and tell them about Maggie's List. I am going to also make sure that every person that I spoke to that told me no, that this wasn't something that they wanted to do at this time, I'm going to make it their time now. When we talk about how do we spread the word, that was one of the things that I'm going to do as far as putting it on my Facebook page. That is like the best thing that I have used as far as marketing. What can you or we do now? We just have to open up our mouths and talk about it.
All right. That's right.
You don't say nothing. This is not going to happen. I'm holding myself accountable. When we come back next year, everybody in this room is held accountable. What am I thinking? I started not to come here today. I was like, I heard the message before, but I didn't do anything about it. I should have made counsel. I regret that. But when I come back here next year and you see my face, I have made counsel. And the reason is because I'm committed to our African American people. I have been looking for something like this in my 47 years that I have worked. I could not find it. I wanted to move up in my company, but I couldn't do it. I kept getting passed by. I have a bachelor's. I have a barber's degree because I said if somebody laid me off, what would happen? I have to make money for myself. I also have a cosmetology license, as well as an MBA. This is what I was looking for. And I have to do it. I am committed to do it. And with the help of each and every one of us in here, this can happen. Thank you.
All right.
I
had to speak. So. Oh. I was here last year. I had another job. My brother had started a few months before me with New York Life, and he wanted me to join New York Life. I have 5 children, so becoming a commission job was not at the top of my list. I decided to come to the African American Convention just to see what it is, to get a feel of it, and I liked what I heard. I became full-time with New York Life December 13 last year, and I'm not sure if I'm proud of what I've done for the 6 months I've been here. I made EC, yeah. To me, that's no big deal. The message that I've carried to each of my clients, I wrote between the time I started in council, I wrote 85 policies. And I only wrote them, I'm not proud of it. I wrote them because of the message that I heard from Eugene, the $50 billion empowerment plan. But guess what? Like the young lady said, most of those families that I sat with, they cannot afford $250,000 worth of life insurance. And that kills me. Because they need it. But I go in there to say, if they have zero and they can only afford 150, I'm gonna let them write the 150. But I can't say I'm proud that they're not where I think they're supposed to be. So my question is for Eugene, and it's, what do I do? I don't know what I do. I don't know. I understand the mission, I'm trying to live the mission, but I don't know what I do. My question to you, what I'm doing, is that sufficient? Eugene?
I think it's a beautiful start. I mean, this is all, you're joining the movement. You're doing what you can with what you've learned and you're making a difference. I mean, just stay with it. You've got all this support network around you. And you know, we can follow up, you know, after this about how we can continue to support you. So, but I'm proud of you. I'm proud of what you've done. 85 lives you've touched now and brought into this mission. So thank you.
Yes, sir. Good evening, everyone. My name is Leslie Carr. I'm also an invited guest. A friend from Cincinnati sent me an email saying that this event was going to be here. I, too, am from Cincinnati, but I've been here for 20 years. I ain't going back, right? But what am I thinking? I'm thinking that it's the accumulation of assets, right? As black. Outside of homes, you know, gentlemen talk about franchises, but what are the other diverse assets that we can get our hands on that really hold their value versus the dollar, right? Because, you know, we're all educated people, so what can we do, right? When we're reading a book, right, it's entertaining, so the ones in our household, they see that we're reading for entertainment and we're not watching television, right? Well, what do you read? Well, I'm reading on monetary history. What's that, right? That's how currency was formed in this country. That's how we need to start accumulating different assets because of, you know, like it or love it, the way that the country is, it's a mess, right? But what can we do? Start it at a level from our internal homes, through our neighborhoods. But as people see us as examples, and I got to give everybody a shout out in the room because you're still sitting in your seat, right? You waited for me to get up because I'm thinking, should I say something, right? Everybody's cleared out. We got it kind of our own, you know, hidden agendas, but you're here because you want to get something. I got something from this today, that we're, as a people, yeah, we, you know, we do what we do, we know what we know, but it's on tag, I'm it. I'm the one that needs to let somebody know something a little bit different every day. I may not be able to save the whole world, but somebody, I'm going to touch somebody every day and let them know about something to make them better. About accumulating assets. That's what I'm thinking. That's what we need to do. Because if we got assets, we're in control.
Okay.
That's right.
Thank you.
All right. So I think we're going to do two more comments. Right?
Three more.
It's like four. Oh, okay. Oh, I have a line. Well, I'm going to stay as long as you say. Right? If it's all night, it's all right for me. So.
Well, I definitely would retreat. I wanted to publicly say, Maggie, I thank God for you. It takes a lot of courage to make that kind of sacrifice.
Indeed.
It's easier to think it and to talk it, but to actually go through it and to go through all the criticism and the mean words and the bad spirits that she had to endure. That takes a lot out of you. Eugene, Maggie and you are a perfect marriage. You truly inspired me. And everybody at my GO who knows me, they know I love life insurance. I think it's the best asset that God gave us. There's nothing that can help us catch up and to fill that gap better than life insurance. You can do investments, you can buy real estate, but it's, and you can get there, but you can't get there with the guarantees and the certainty that life insurance brings you. When my father passed away, I think my mom had a $10,000 policy. And she spent that policy on that funeral, all of it, with stuff that she didn't have to have. And she ended up getting married again. I mean, she was in her 60s and she married someone, I think, 79 or 80. But she did it for security because she needed the help. She didn't have anything. So she had to marry someone for security. And as it turns out, she ended up really loving him. But she did it for security, I believe. And sometimes we have to do what's best for us, and not necessarily what we want to do. You have to make those decisions sometimes. And nobody ever told me about life insurance until I joined New York Life. And I truly believe in it. I own a $1 million policy and permanent whole life insurance. And I feel like each and every one of us in this room should own nothing less than $1 million. So I just wanted to say kudos to Maggie, kudos to Eugene and his staff. We really appreciate you, we love you, and we thank you.
Good evening. This is my first time ever standing in the mic with a group in about 4 years. But I've been pushed from behind for Mr. Hicks. I want to say congratulations to each and every one of you, especially to Eugene, for doing a fabulous job. Maggie, couldn't do it without you. You've been tremendous throughout all the time that I've come. I've been around 27 years, so I've been around the block a few times, seen a lot of things. But the one thing that I want to share with you today that Mr. Hicks and I spoke about was about thinking and how we're going to do business. You need to tap into these franchises. And he didn't go as far as I want you to go. And that is you go into all of them. They all need every aspect of insurance, not just one side. So So on the financial services side, which is where most of us play, you have the opportunity not only to do key mans, buy-sell agreements, estate tax planning, etc. It's there. Get on the phone and get after it.
Required.
They have to have it. They have to have it. Find a way to get the number, get in, and make it happen.
Peace, black man.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Maggie, Eugene, Brother Hicks, New York Life, finally met you. I'm Michael Hill, CEO and President of the Atlanta Metropolitan Black Chamber of Commerce, and I know business.
Yes,
I have
sir.
Seen it at all levels, all sizes. We got it. From organizations, we consider ourselves a one-stop shop. I've been doing this 9 years. And I understand blood, sweat, and tears. You gotta be a pastor, you gotta be a preacher, you gotta be all kinds of things in this position, particularly when you have to love black people. Because it's not easy. I've seen it all. But one thing I want to say is that I appreciate you, New York Life, because this presentation is something I've been trying to tell all the agents that have ever from other companies. I said, you have to relate to the cultural nuances of the community to get the message. So, one, where can I sign up?
Okay.
And get my members signed up.
Okay.
But this message is the message that I want to take not only locally, but this is a message that I want to take to the national level. I also serve on the President's Council for the U.S. Black Chamber of Commerce. So this is a huge opportunity. I appreciate what you're doing. I just want to say that I love this. This is a very unique proposition. One of the things that we've done when we talk about the trillion-dollar marketplace is that we have segmented those trillion dollars into 25 top billion-dollar sectors in which African-Americans spend business. Next steps for me is I want to get with the Atlanta team. I want us to sit down and I want to show you a holistic process in which we have with partners with AARP, SBA, FDIC, and what we are launching statewide to be a national program to really take people through all the processes of what they need to have a financial solution. What I've seen tonight and what Brother Hicks is talking about, which is the end in mind, when you get to that status, that is truly the retirement plan. But my grandfather was an insurance agent at Pilgrim's Insurance, which is an African-American-owned insurance company supervisor. He died when I was 6, but I'll tell you this, his policy that he put in place for me got me into college. So I understand the importance of this thing. So thank you for what you're doing tonight. Thank you, Eugene. I support this wholeheartedly. Maggie, thank you for being the voice of our consumers, our community, and Brother Hicks, we fixing to change the world up in here.
Yes, sir.
It's going to be on and popping because we are doers. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. So for all of us who are members of the New York Life family, right, in the African American Marketing Unit, have a chamber in their community, right?
Yep.
So earlier today, Renee talked about, you know, she said Rob one more time and Eugene was going to kick it, right? But when she invited me to come to Grand Rapids and speak in front of 500 folks, the next place she took me was to the Black Chamber, right? And I told them our story.
Right.
Well, these people won't leave me alone, right? So it's just fabulous when you get connected. As the young brother just said, go home and go see the Black Chamber. If you're not a member, join. Tell them your story. They'll do exactly what this young man did. They'll say, you know what, that's a great story. And you know what, I need to get some of that too. And then I need to have you come and talk to all the other members of the chamber, because that's what happens. Right, I've been in 3 different cities. It happened the same way every time, right? And then they say, we're having our annual event. Can you come and speak? They wanted to pay me to come and speak. I was so tempted to take the money, right? So I said, no, I can't get the money, right? But I will come and speak, right? That's how compelling your message is, right? All kidding aside, your message is that compelling. They were so motivated and inspired by the message, which you just saw tonight, they didn't want to pay to get it, right? Just go visit with these folks, right? But you got to join up, right?
You got to get involved. You got to tell them what you're passionate about, and they'll embrace you. Okay? All right. So thank you for that comment. We love that. Yes, sir.
Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Victor Bomi. I'm a real estate investor here in the Atlanta, Georgia area.
All right.
I'm also a 23-year-old entrepreneur and business owner. Yes, and you know, I would say I might be the youngest person here, but the reason why I purposely want to tell everybody my age here is because I've been very inspired by this event. You know, I've been a business owner since I was maybe 19. I was actually invited by executive council member Mr. Isaac Onu of New York Life. This is my first event of, you know, kind of supporting you guys in your organization. And I'm gonna just kind of go through the questions that you guys have on the screen. What am I thinking?
Yeah.
First of all, I'm a Nigerian, so I'm actually not originally from here. I'm Nigerian. And one thing I know, not even just with the Black culture, but with my culture as well, we're all about show. We like to kind of show what we have. And you know, it's a highly consumptive lifestyle that's promoted in our communities. So what am I thinking? I'm thinking that, you know, just to kind of piggyback off of one of the gentlemen that spoke before me, is we need to change the mindset of the community more so to communicate the importance of accumulating, you know, assets and building your net worth and, you know, more financial education and literacy in our communities. You know, I think that one of the biggest problems in the Black community is, you know, they always kind of glamorize a highly consumptive lifestyle of, you know, spending, spending, and spending. And I think that, you know, if we start, you know, maybe at a young age of educating our children, you know, on the importance of, you know, financial education, you know, we could actually cut off some of the problems, you know, at the very root in the beginning. What can we do now is, you know, as has been said earlier, you know, the people you know, starting your immediate network, people that you work with and interact with on a day-to-day basis, you know, just kind of educating them on the importance of getting a life insurance policy, mm-hmm. the importance of investing in real estate, stocks, or whatever the case may be, and, you know, starting from somewhere. How do we spread the word? I believe that, again, word of mouth, marketing, but, you know, one thing that I think is also important is media. You know, I think he who controls the media really controls the masses. So how can we really get into the media, like a CNN? You know, another thing I want to say, actually I have to give a lot of respect to Miss Maggie. You know, I was very inspired by her, you know, her words and what she's doing and her fearlessness. And I think we have to be fearless. You know, we shouldn't be afraid to communicate how proud we are to be Black. And, you know, we shouldn't be afraid to put our life on the line for what we, if we really care about it, we should be able to put our life on the line. Because you know what? The people who lived back then, they did, and that's why we're here today. So that's one thing I want to say. If you don't remember anything I say today, remember to be fearless and not be afraid. The next steps, you know, again, you know, just communicate with the people you know, and, you know, just start from somewhere and, you know, continue on to spread the message. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, New York Live!
Woo-hoo!
Wake up! My name is Roberta Bihiray. I'm from Houston, Texas. And I am a Nigerian-born Black. But I came to the United States when I was 16 years old. And I have duly served my Black community. I attended Texas Southern University, volunteering with Barbara Jordan, Mickey Leland, and when Dr. Perry and also some other people that were in charge of the African American community, also African students, they would organize us to serve for the Democratic Party. And I attended Wesley Chapel AME Church for years. And I was in charge of the Martin Luther King Center. I've been doing community work over and over for Black community. When I heard Sister Anderson spoke, it reminds me of Barbara Jordan, Mickey Lennon, and a host of people, including my friend Sheila Lee Jackson. I just wanted to cry. because it's a continuous movement. We cannot stop. Most people don't know, some of us sitting in here have really served. I have taught in Black community school and also came to Atlanta 2 years ago because HIS, they gave me $1,700 because my kids passed well. It's because I dedicated my life to go to school every morning before 6, and I teach them, make sure they pass, and I stay till 9:30. And because of that, God rewarded me with Sam Bridgman, who saw me and said that, I want you to work for New York Life. Mm. And when I listened to him, it's like somebody poured a bucket of water on me. And I said, God, what is this? Why should I come and work for an insurance company when I'm training to be a principal? So I said, oh, Lord, what can I do? The Lord spoke to me, and I became a member of New York Life. Then God told me, and I'm saying God told me, to serve my community.
From Eugene tonight, what you presented was so profound in terms of your vision, in terms of your understanding of the history that leads to that vision, to that conclusion, and for you to bring that into a corporate context and then challenge the people around you to support that type of vision. I wish that more of our corporate successful people would develop visions like that, because we can change the world overnight. And we have to understand that when we help ourselves, we are helping the world. But sometimes we feel guilty about helping ourselves. Mm-hmm. But helping us is helping the world. It's kind of like the NBA, the reason why they, at the end of every year, they give the top picks to the worst teams, because they know that helps the whole league get better. Mm-hmm. So if we want to help America get better, want to help the world get better, then we have to understand. Of our time, of our people. So I just want you to know that, and that I appreciate that as a consultant, because that is exactly what I'm attempting to teach businesses. Like your brother was talking about, rendering high quality service for our people. If you don't value these people that you're talking about, those 200,000 people, they're not gonna join.
That's right.
Right? Now you have to understand the key when you talk about what can we do right now is understand your market, which is really your community, right? A market is a community of people. These are real people you're talking about. These are not just numbers. These are real people, and the biggest tool you have in your arsenal for reaching them is compassion. What Maggie has shown us in her book, Our Black Here, which again, is probably the most important black business book written in the last 20 years. And I have a library of black business books, or books written on business by black people, for black people. I have that library. So her book is so important. It's not just her story. It's the history. It's what's happening, and it's where we must go and what we can do. So I would say what we can do now, make sure you have that book in your collection. Every person who is an agent should understand and give themselves a context from which I am working in, so that I understand my value in the process. Because if I understand my value in the process, I can begin the journey of appreciating the value of the people around me. What makes marketing work? All the stuff we're talking about in terms of the Instagram, the Facebook, all the tools and all that, it's social media. Not media, social. Social is the interaction between people. That is driven by the valuing of people. And to value other people is to understand who they are, to have that compassion for who they are. It's not just beating them up, calling them names, these people are this. It's actually coming from a place of compassion. I feel it here, but I think you can take it out into the world and really utilize that as a strategy. How do we spread the word? So I'm sure you know by now, if you go, you know, even look at your television, you'll notice that most of the commercials you see don't look like you. Right? Our people are over-advertised to, right, by people that don't look like them, and quite frankly, don't care about them. This is one of the issues that many of our advertising agencies are pushing for corporations to pay attention to us, that you should market to us. And they have determined they don't even need to put our images in front of us because of this problem. People like us need to show them different. That when you value those people, they value you in return. That's the formula that we have to figure out. So to me, that's the key to spreading the word. And what are the next steps that, as you see them? How many people in here are consumers? How many don't spend money probably by the end of the night, right? Okay, so, you know, the conscious consumer movement that Maggie's talking about is key. It does. If you make all the money in the world and you just take it back to those folks, you miss the whole point. Right? If we teach those people, if we give them $50 billion and they take that $50 billion, give it right back and say, okay, and they don't do the starting of the businesses like the sister's talking about, we don't do those kinds of things. That happens because her father educated her appropriately. Mm-hmm. And so we need to become not just marketers, but educators of our people, because I think that's the way forward. Marketing, the new marketing is education. Education. Teach our people the way, and they will follow.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. So this young man said that he thought
want to say, when you do business with a business owner, then you need to buy those books and give him a gift. Mm-hmm. Give that book as a gift. We always give him gifts. I mean, I'm sure if you buy a book, it'll be on
right,
you.
You can buy a book.
Honor that number.
Thanks, friend.
Hi, my name is Raynell Mensa. I am a very new agent. I just started in February, and I am from the Greater New York office.
All right.
And so what I'm hearing here is there's a lot of teaching going on as far as getting the word out. The approach is for us to teach, and we're doing these analyses and these high-level sort of explanations of what's going on in terms of the racial wealth gap. I think one thing that might be missing is in terms of spreading the word. I spent 6 years in the pharmaceutical industry where one thing that I became very familiar with is something we call the patient journey. So we would get somebody who had undergone some kind of treatment with some kind of medication, they had a condition, and basically it's usually a long kind of experience where they spend several years in and out of treatment, and finally they're able to come to a place where they're healthy again, they have time with their families, etc. And I think what I see that might be missing from here, from spreading the message, is hearing from people whose lives have been changed by those policies in the social media kind of format. And so I wanted to just put that out there as an idea, something that we can take forward and use those who have already received the benefit and experienced the benefit of life insurance to tell that story on our behalf and to take that story into places that we're not reaching at this point.
Great idea. Great idea. Thank you. Well, So what makes a town hall special is people are compelled to go forward and take action, right? So now you've witnessed it, you've seen it, you've lived it, and your assignment going forward is to have another one. You don't have to have 200 people, 300 people. You can have 10 people in your living room, right? You can invite one of us to come to your family reunion, right? If you have Bible study, summer Bible study, we can come and talk about financial literacy at your Bible study class, right? I can't carry a tune in the suitcase, but I'll show up for choir rehearsal if you let me talk about the 50-50, right? Do you get it, right? So we have to all be innovative and creative about how we get the message out. See, door to door, house to house, belly to belly, right? That's how it has to get done. So with that, we thank you very much for participating. I want to invite us all to let's have a sellout on Maggie's book over here, right? So she can stay on her mission. Eugene, thank you very much, and thank all of you. Have a great evening, and drive safely going home.